Hi all, welcome to today's session. Today we are going to discuss MacFlex No lines 100 to 151. I have given the link of the previous video in the description box. So lines 100 to 151. The day of Shadwell's coronation. So it is the auspicious day of Shadwell's coronation. And one can see the works of mediocre poets and even Shadwell lining the floors of the walkway. Built stationers for yeomen stood prepared, and Herringham was captain of the guard. Here Dryden says that the built stationers here reference to the publishers and booksellers who cannot sell Shadwell's shoddy works. So these people have lined up there and they have joined the yeoman service. Yeoman here means the royal attendants. So these built stationers are now in the yeoman service. And Henry Herringham, it is a reference to a publisher who published Shadwell's work. And Henry Herringham is portrayed as a publisher who stands the captain of this yeoman service. The hoary prince in majesty appeared, high on a throne of his own labours reared, and his right hand our young Ascanius sat, Rome's other hope and pillar of the state. And now the aged Flecno appears. Finally, the hoary here means aged. Aged prince appears on stage in all his majesty. And he is sitting on the top of a throne that is made up of his own works. And we can see that Shadwell is seated at his right hand. And Shadwell is compared to the young Ascanius. At his right hand, our young Ascanius sat, Rome's other hope and pillar of the state. Here, Flecno compares Shadwell to Ascanius. Ascanius, the son of Aeneas, and he is a hero featured in Virgil's The Aeneid. Ascanius also sat at his father's right side and inherited the kingdom. So just like Ascanius here, Dryden says that Shadwell too sat on the right side of the throne and thus inherited the kingdom of dullness from his father Flecno. We can see that the allusion of Ascanius reinforces the mock heroic tone here, and Shadwell is compared to the classical heroes of the bygone ages. His brows, thick fogs instead of glories, grace, and lampant dullness played around his face, as Hannibal did to the altar scheme. Here Dryden ironically comments on Shadwell's dullness as lambent. Lambent here means glowing around his face. And the irony is that he has deliberately used the word lambent, that means glowing, as if it were the radiance of wit. One may feel that radiance is owing to the presence of wit or wisdom. And Shadwell's brows are compared to thick fogs of dullness. And there is also another allusion in these lines, the allusion to Hannibal. Hannibal was the general from Carthage who, on the orders of his father, waged constant war against Rome, the great Roman Empire. And here Dryden says that, just like the great Hannibal who waged war against Rome, here Shadwell too made a vow, a promise. In the presence of his father, that he shall maintain his true dullness until death, and shall never ever come in peaceful terms with wit. So Shadwell also swears constant war against wit. The king himself, the sacred unction made, as king by office and as priest by trade, in his sinister hand, instead of ball, he placed a mighty mug of potent ale. Now the aged king, this having made his own unction of ale, places another mug of the same in his son Shadwell's hands too. Now the aged king advances to the ceremonies of coronation. As part of the ceremonial rites, he anoints his son with ale. Ale here means a beer, an alcoholic drink. So the king, the aged king, having made his own unction of the ale, now hands over a mug of ale to his son Shadwell. Here look at the lines, the king himself, the sacred unction made, as king by office and as priest by trade. As king by office and as priest by trade, it is reference to Richard Flecno. And here we should remember that Richard Flecno, though he was a poet, he was also a priest. And here Dryden has deliberately used the term unction, which refers to the process of anointing a new king with sacramental oil, which was performed by the priests. And so it is a direct reference to Richard Flecno, who was a priest. So Flecknoe placed a mug of ale on his left hand and Shadwell's own work Love's Kingdom to his right hand. Love's Kingdom is Shadwell's own play. So Flecknoe has placed a mug of ale on Shadwell's sinister hand. Sinister hand means left hand. And the work Love's Kingdom to his right hand. That is a reference to the coronation ceremony that was practiced in England. During the coronation ceremony, the King of England would be given a scepter and orb, similar to a ball, as a symbol of power. And here Flecknoe has handed over the ale and Love's Kingdom, that is equivalent to the scepter and orb, which symbolizes power or dominion over the kingdom of dullness. His temples last with poppies were overspread that nodding seemed to consecrate his head. And Flecknoe here consecrates his son's head with a wreath of poppies. Not with a wreath of any kind of flowers or laurels, but here he has consecrated his son's head with a wreath of poppies. And here poppies, we know it is the source. It is from the poppy seeds that opium is being extracted or manufactured. So it refers to Shadwell's addiction towards opium. And here Dryden is making fun of Shadwell's practice or Shadwell's addiction towards opium. Just at that point of time, if fame not lie, on his left hand 12 reverend owls did fly. So Romulus, it is sung by Tiber's brook, presage of sway from twice 6 vultures took. Suddenly, during the ceremonies of coronation was in advance, 12 owls were seen flying from his left hand, which easily reminds one of the great Romulus. The great Romulus here reference to the founder of ancient Roman Empire. It is believed that 12 vultures constantly visited Romulus, who told him where to establish the kingdom of Rome. And here Dryden compares Shadwell's coronation to the founding of great Roman Empire. So just as Romulus was visited by the 12 vultures, here Dryden says that during the ceremonies of Shadwell's coronation, 12 owls instead of 12 vultures, 12 owls were seen hovering over his head from his left hand. Here once again, Dryden reinforces a tone of mock heroic by comparing the trivial ceremony of Shadwell's coronation to the great act of founding Rome. And on watching this, the crowd made a large applause. The admiring throng loud acclamations make and omens of his future empire take. The sire then shook the oars off his head and from his brows damps of oblivion shed full on the filial dullness. The crowd who stood witnessing the ceremony made a large round of applause and the aged king Flecknoe shook his head. At that point the aged king Flecknoe shook his head from which drops of oblivion shed here. So at this point, the aged king shook his head and from his head drops of oblivion shed and it fell on the head of his son Shadwell. Here oblivion means the darkness or dullness, which is a representation of Flecknoe's ignorance, and that is being imparted to his son Shadwell too. Here Dryden actually make fun of Flecknoe that he literally sweats oblivion. Even what he sweat is oblivion, darkness or dullness. So now Flecknoe has imparted the filial dullness to his son and now gets ready to address the crowd. Now it is time to address the crowd. Heavens, bless my son. From Ireland, let him reign to far Barbados on the western main. Here, the aged king invokes heaven's blessings for his son Shadwell to rule the vast kingdom stretching from Ireland to Barbados. Here, the kingdom is being mentioned as a vast one stretching from Ireland to Barbados. Here, Dryden has turned purely ironical because the reason is that what lies between Ireland and the great Barbados is the vast Atlantic. There is no kingdom between Ireland and Barbados. So here Dryden is once again making fun of Flecknoe and Shadwell. The proud father then hopes that his son's dominion shall one day encompass the entire universe and he shall produce dull plays for the dim-witted. Of his dominion may no end be known and greater than his father's be thrown. Of his dominion may no end be known and greater than his father's be his throne. Here Flecknoe blesses his son and hopes that His dominion may see no end and let it flourish even greater than his father's throne. Let it flourish beyond love's kingdom and let your pen stretch beyond what all you have produced so far. And he hopes that his son's domain shall one day encompass the entire universe and he shall produce more dull plays for the dim-witted. And now Flecknoe pauses so that the people can cry Amen. Then thus continued he, my son, advance still a new impudence, new ignorance, and success let other teach. Learn thou from me pangs without birth and fruitless industry. He continues with admiration that his son shall advance in impudence as well as ignorance. And Flecknoe hopes that Shadwell will produce more dull plays than Virtuoso. Virtuoso here is reference to Shadwell's work, in which no one can spot any traces of wit or wisdom. So let my son's wit be represented by his own characters like Lovett, Cully, Cockwood and the like. So let him produce more and more dull plays and more absurd, foolish characters. And let his fame spread the entire universe. In short, Flecknoe says that let him produce more and more terrible works. So let us wind up today's session and shall continue with the explanation of lines 151 to 200 in the next session. So thank you for listening and watching.